games as a medium for teaching and learning is really something that's based on experiential learning. Internships are a form of experiential learning. Cooperatives are experiential learning. Study abroad can be considered experiential learning, but a lot of people don't really criticize those individual programs.
A few months back, I got a report sent to me by a small school. You may have heard of it, Harvard Business School. Jaime, have you heard of Harvard?
No.
Small school. They have a recent report that dropped coming out talking about the effectiveness of games when it comes to workforce training and development. Most specifically, they released a report that talks about the fact that in this case study, I believe they used KPMG as their study group, but they created a game platform to try to onboard and upskill sales reps faster for KPMG, produced a ton of different results, drove more sales, better engagement, all types of interaction, which is kind of cool. And as a as somebody who is a part of a company that turns workforce training into games, obviously caught my attention, but it was another reason for us to reach out to our next guest, Dr. Dave Eng. Dave is the creative educator, designer, and researcher focused on games theory and technology, and he is a faculty member at New York University's School of Professional Studies. He studies applied games, teaches others how to use games for education, learning, teaching, training. So if you're a people leader interested in games, gamification, want to learn how do you use these mechanics appropriately, you're not going to want to miss this episode. So now let's hear from our next guest, Dr. Dave Eng. Let's bring it in.
To kick us off, do you mind maybe giving a little background on yourself?
Sure. My name's Dave Eng. I lead the website. So it's universityxp.com. It's where I write and podcast and have my own video series about using games for teaching, learning, and development. And by extension of that, I also run the Gamespace Learning Alliance, which is a collection of other academics and professionals and thinkers and thought leaders who also use games for learning. And we also put together our annual Gamespace Learning Virtual Conference, which is a virtual online event that connects other people from around the world that are also looking forward to using games, game-based learning, gamification, serious games, simulations, and all of that. So you could say that I'm a leader in the training, learning, and education space, but specifically also using games for learning and development.
What made you kind of get into, sounds pretty fun. What made you get into that line of work?
So it's interesting because my background is almost exclusively in higher education. And at the time, I knew that I wanted to become a senior administrator in higher education, so in academia. And in order to do that, I needed to spend some more time. I needed to go back to grad school. I needed to get my terminal degree, doctorate. And at the time, my advisor said that I have to pick a dissertation topic. It's got to be something that I'm enthusiastic about. But also know that I'm going to be spending several years researching this topic. And at the time, and this was when the new, I guess, renaissance of tabletop games were coming up, me being a gamer from a very early age, it was just very germane to me. And I figured, you know, is there a way or is there a field that combines games with learning and development? And I discovered games-based learning, and that was the start of a 4+ year, or I would say that started in 2014. So almost 10-year journey now of researching, finding games, learning how to use games for learning and development, finding other people who are creating games. So it came about from a need, a specific need to finish a program, and it just kind of blossomed into something else. So I can't say that this is the path that I predicted for myself, but I'm happy to be on the journey.
I bet some people are surprised that games have such a long history, and there's programs like the ones you're describing that focus on games within academia and for learning and for skill development. I guess to give folks that don't know maybe a little background or history, I mean, how long and how serious is this concept of using games in a environment for learning and training and development?
So the interesting part about this is that using games for teaching and learning is almost as old as games itself. And one of the earliest examples that I think a lot of listeners may realize is that war games have been used for centuries now on how to train officers, soldiers, leaders, even, you know, politicians and policymakers on the outcomes of different scenarios. And one of the earliest examples I would say is the Kriegsspiel, which is a German tabletop game. Krieg meaning war and Spiel meaning game in German. And what was interesting about it was that it was what we see today in a lot of like hobby gamings, like tabletop war games, in that different commanders and officers would play out these different scenarios on a tabletop, where they would, one side would represent an opposing force, one side would represent the home force, and they would essentially play this war game against each other. And they had a referee in the middle that would kind of negotiate some of the details of the specific war game. And what was interesting about it is that there was an immediate reflection on the application that this could be used for teaching and learning, specifically military officers. But there was also a fun aspect of it, this this ability to create and control this microcosm of this tiny world. So while war games do have a very specific application, there are other ways that games can be used for teaching and learning, specifically like gamification that we see now in a lot of different learning management systems.
Are there, I'd imagine that you have heard or hear at times people who may challenge the seriousness of, you know, of a course or a topic that uses a game as the vehicle. I guess, what do you say to people who, you know, and obviously you just kind of talked to it a little bit with war games, because that's some pretty serious stuff. But I guess, why do you think there's this point of view that because something is a game, it's not to be taken seriously, or it's just all play and not purposeful?
I think it's because a lot of people have their own interpretation of what they see as games. Those that really kind of dismiss games as not really having an application outside of entertainment are really thinking about games like Angry Birds or mobile games or games that have just pure, I guess, engagement value. You know, they were just things that an activity to do or something to play with and engage with, but not really have a lot of meaning. But what I tell people is that games as a medium for teaching and learning is really something that's based on experiential learning. And experiential learning is learning taking place through experience. And one of the phrases I like to use most often is that learning is the transformation of experience into knowledge. And I use that as the basis for really honoring the kind of contribution that games can be used for learning. Because right now, experiential learning is seen in a lot of different formats. Internships are a form of experiential learning. Cooperatives are experiential learning. Study abroad can be considered experiential learning. But a lot of people don't really criticize those individual programs. I mean, a lot of people would say that internships are a very critical part of starting your career. But these are all ways that we can learn through experience. Likewise, games are a form of experiential learning, because when you think about it, a game contains a specific structure for how you interact with it. But that structure can really be in the hands of a skilled professional, be whatever you want it to be. Like with the Kriegsspiel, that's a simulation of an actual, you know, like warlike scenario. But that doesn't also mean that you can't make simulations of other things that aren't warlike. Probably a game, and I guess I'm kind of dating myself here, is when I played the stock market game in high school. That is a simulation. While it did use actual data from stock market trading, it happened within a closed simulation of just my other classmates and I. And through that, we learned how different equities trade, what it means to buy and sell different stocks at different times, and how to evaluate a company and everything else. And I would say that that's not something that a lot of people criticize, even though it is a serious game, that stock market trading game.
I'm sure you've seen all types of good games and bad games, or proper uses and misuses of gamification around teaching and learning. Mm-hmm. I guess for folks out there that are considering implementing a form of gamification into their workplace, whether that's for learning or whether it's for engagement or whether it's for connection, whether it's for productivity, any insights around like what are the few things you should do and the few things maybe you should stay away from?
One of the things I see most often, and this is probably a consideration of why a lot of people use gamification, is because it's very easy to implement right now. One of the things that we see regularly is just the use of points. People quantify different activities and you earn points for doing certain things, or maybe you lose points for doing other things. And that's fine. I think points at face value can be useful. But when it's only used to quantify different activities, it isn't very indicative of a very focused learning and development approach. One of the examples I like to use is, because I own one, I have a Fitbit. Fitbit is really great at gamifying quote-unquote behavior, in that different activities are quantified based on the statistics and insights generated from the actual tracker, like steps, active minutes, and everything else. But those statistics on its own are not very useful. But when you can combine them with incentives to do different things, then they are useful. One of the things I like doing regularly with Fitbit is earning different badges for steps earned during a certain time or active minutes during the week or anything else. Likewise, whenever you are using gamification, points at face value are not a bad thing. But how are you giving those points out? How are they awarded? And are they attached to anything else? I would say one of the more successful applications of using points in a learning management system is, one, to track progress for a specific course or module or anything else, but then also awarding a credential at the completion of it. And points can be used in order to inform what credential you offer, when it's offered, and how it's offered. But at face value, just giving points to something could be interpreted as gamification, but I wouldn't say it's a very good use of gamification.
I'm sure you've seen this is dating maybe a year or two ago, but Amazon utilized a technology inside of their warehousing space where one of their challenges was their pick and packers, the folks that were literally packing the boxes on the front lines. They were struggling to make sure that people were picking and packing a certain number of boxes per hour, whatever the standard number was. Let's say it's 50 boxes an hour. And one of the things they did is they created a technology to create a leaderboard, and they put all of the workers up on the leaderboard against each other in lieu of a manager or a shift leader. So this was sort of a way for them to avoid investing in coaching and development, but instead sort of create an environment where the workers pushed each other. And it got a lot of pretty critical reviews because of the fact that in many ways it started to create a negative cultural impact where, one person who just so happened to be a little bit healthier and in a position to pack 75 boxes versus the person who maybe couldn't pack and was only packing 25. I don't know if you're familiar with this story, but I'm throwing it out there as a deeper question around how we should be thinking about the opportunity for games, especially when we're thinking about, frontline workers or workers who are coming from different backgrounds and different education levels and different, are bringing different things into the workplace. And then to have work, gamification sprinkled over or injected into their day-to-day functions. I guess, I'd love to hear your opinion on that and guidance to folks that are, considering a way to implement gamification that's not going to have a negative impact.
Sure. So I'm really glad you brought up that story, Sam, because some of my colleagues and I presented in the past on the dark side of gamification, quote unquote. It's gamification used often with very dubious ethical considerations. And the top three considerations I would bring up for this particular question is, one, the Amazon incident that you talked about before. And I think that it is exploitative of workers in order to emphasize different productivity goals through this app. There are different ways that you can implement this that I think is less exploitative, particularly if you make it an opt-in experience or something that isn't necessarily tied to compensation or performance or anything else. Another instance in which we have observed something like this happening is with, I believe it was the Disney World Resort down in Orlando, where they had a gamified system for hotel laundry workers to turn over loads of laundry in a gamified system at a faster pace in order to get more people to complete cycles of laundry faster. However, it did have a negative impact with specific workers not taking offered breaks during their shift because they wanted to stay on top of the gamified leaderboard. And then a third instance, and this one is more pervasive, that we kind of see in regular, I would say, commercial games, is this aspect of loot boxes. And for those who are listening who are not familiar with loot boxes, they are a form of randomized prizes, usually related to a specific game, that is in the form of cosmetics, like different character skins or clothing or anything else. But those loot boxes can be earned through gameplay, or they can be purchased. And because you are incentivizing your players to purchase them, it's sort of like a gambling mechanic of paying a certain amount of money and not being able to generally discover what you're going to get from this particular loot box. So I'd say that these are all instances of gamification implemented in dubious ethical circumstances. They're definitely not ways that I would want to implement gamification, but these are definitely individual aspects to look out for and to try to avoid when possible.
It just makes me think, one of the most powerful opportunities or maybe critical ingredients of a great game is that it's fair, that there's a level, like everybody's on essentially a level playing field and can have the opportunity to compete or pursue, an outcome. Again, as you talk about those three scenarios, it's, I think it's really, really timely, especially given the environment today. One in two mm-hmm. workers are low wage workers. They're in many ways a parking ticket away from poverty, and they're coming mm-hmm. to work every day. And the story about Disney, it's wild. Like, again, can imagine a laundry, a worker on the front lines in the situation like housekeeping or laundry who is skipping a break because mm-hmm. of the impact of what the game or the effect that a game could have on them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think it also speaks to the responsibility, right, leaders have today to think about their workforce and when they think about how they design and what tools they use. Mm-hmm. One other question for you, and I appreciate you taking the time with us mm-hmm. today. So much of what you're talking about, Dave, affects people in the workplace. And as we think about future of work, interested in your point of view around, what is your hope for the future of work?
It's an interesting question, Sam, because I'd say that my real future, my hope for the future of work is something that will always reward an individual's intrinsic motivation to do something. And I say that right now because the way our society works and the way the work is structured right now is that people must work in order to survive. Whereas I think I'm thinking of Star Trek Next Generation right now, where it's a post-scarcity society, where if you'd like to work, you can work, but you're not forced to do work in order to just survive, whereas your basic needs are met. I'd say that an idealized future work for me is one where if you choose to work, you can do work that I think is very fulfilling for yourself, is very interesting for yourself, is not necessary from a survival standpoint, but is really kind of, I would say, quote unquote, feed your soul. If you're familiar with Arthur Maslow's hierarchy of needs, this is the highest level of individual need, which is self-actualization. Once you've met all those other biological needs like food, air, water, sleep, a sense of belonging and everything else, self-actualization is the height of human potential. So while it sounds kind of idealistic of me to think about it like that, I really hope it's something that, in the not so far future we can attain. But that is really my idealized version of what I see work looking like in the future.
Dave, thank you for taking time.
You got it. Thank you, Sam, for having me. I appreciate it.
So a lot of big takeaways here from Dr. Dave Eng. Here's a few of them from my list. Talking about the long history of humanity using games to learn. I think this is something a lot of people forget about, is that, games didn't just pop up a few years ago and hear, ooh, gamification. Like, games have a long history, not just 50 years back, but thousands of years. Play being hardwired into the way that we evolved. So play being really powerful, play being the foundation of games, and that's some really interesting points that sometimes people need to be reminded of. Also, I think it was an interesting contrast. You know, we think about internships, apprenticeships, and those types of activities as experiential, but why is it that, you know, as you, quote, grow up, we start to look at play as not purposeful, or we look at play as not something of value and not experiential. I thought that point is really important. You know, play is, again, hardwired into our behaviors. I also thought his point around it not being, because it's never been easier to add gamification into work and learning, because of that, it also means it's never been easier to, like, create bad games. And we talked a little bit about this, and we see this in technology platforms that employ points and badges and leaderboards to sort of trick you into doing things. Amazon, and obviously they're not the only ones out there that are bad actors doing this, but to the point of the dark side of gamification, you know, these mechanics may create habit loops that, if you are an employer, if you are a product that knows your product sucks or your job is bad, you may employ some of these mechanics at work in order to try to extract and exploit, not engage and entertain. I think finally, you know, we'll ending on Dr. Eng's comment around his hope for the future of work, talking about hoping that work becomes a source of self-actualization. You know, one of the most powerful mechanics in any game is the sense of autonomy you afford the player. No autonomy means it ain't a game anymore. Allowing the player to make choices, I think, is a critical requirement and component of the future of work. It's on us to make that happen. So thanks to Dave Eng for joining us today. You can head on over to DaveEngDesign.com, DaveEngDesign.com, to check out more from Dr. Dave Eng, all of his research, newsletters, podcasts, episodes, events. He does a ton of stuff in the New York area. So go over and show him some love if you're interested in learning a little bit more. And don't forget to subscribe to Bring It In so you never miss an episode. We've got some awesome guests lined up that you're not going to want to miss. Now, back to work.